Well, a very warm welcome to this special chat. I have with me someone who has been in news of late, the company that has really got the public cloud out there, and it's a made in India product. I have with me Arnab Mitra from DigiVox. Thank you very much, Arnab, for joining us today. I want to begin by asking you about the kind of traction public cloud storage has taken in India, considering that cloud storage has become a very, very important part of all of our lives.
Right. Thank you, Priya. Thank you so much. Thank you, your story, for this opportunity. I mean, 6 months back, I think I also got a chance to talk to Shraddha, and again, 6 months. So I'm glad we survived for 6 months. But in reality, I think we did a little more than just surviving, honestly. I think one of the things that also kind of, the kind of traction we got was unprecedented. And hand on heart, when we launched, we actually thought that we are possibly going to, probably get 10,000 odd users by March 2021. So we had a board meeting, and some of us, we were like, together sitting, and one of my senior partners asked me, "So Arnab, what do you think, how many users we will get?" So I said, "I think we will get about 10,000 odd users." So we were prepared for about a lakh of total user and maybe 10,000 paid users. It happened, so we probably did 10x, right? So we touched about, currently as we speak, I think about 11,06,000 users, as we speak today, and almost 10% of them are paid customers. We realized the need of a cloud platform long back, but when we did a survey, Priya, you'll be surprised that we keep on saying this, that there is India and then there is a Bharat that lives inside India, right? That Bharat did not have a product for them. Okay. And I think DigiVox is that sweet spot that they needed. Most of them do not communicate in English. Most of them do not understand a very complex platform. Most of them just want basic service, which will allow them to just sync their phones, upload photos, videos, chat backups, etc. And most importantly, they also need a value for money product, right? Something that doesn't pinch their pocket, something that, fits their pocket. So I think that way, that is how DigiVox probably have been able to kind of get the traction. Luckily for us, I think we also got some influential people taking note, thanks to, and like to the extent we got a tweet from Mr. Sonu Sood wishing us good luck. I think it is also because Amitabh Kanji launched us, and maybe he was just following, and few others, so that's really been the story. We didn't plan for this, but it feels good that, we've been able to make a product that could cater to so many people.
One thing that really stands out in this entire public cloud storage space is that, you have giants like you have a Google and you have a Microsoft, and you have so many tech giants who are slowly and surely making most of the cloud services. Cloud storage at this point in time is a very, very small market in terms of the kind of users and the kind of providers out there. So do you think that this perhaps has been a really big factor that led to you leapfrogging in terms of more attracting more users onto your platform?
I would love to say a clean yes, but I think the answer is yes and no, and I'll try and explain, right? Data sovereignty is an issue, and it's a question in a lot of our minds. In the last couple of years, what has happened, because of the geopolitical situation around us and also COVID, etc., we have realized that all countries are being extremely cautious about laying their foundation. Because for a very, very long time, people thought that internet is a fad, digital is just a way of interacting, etc., etc. Nobody realized that digital is going to become the mainstream life. Now, I think maybe a year back, this interview would have possibly done, by either you flying into Bombay or me flying to Bangalore or wherever, this could have been, So I think people have now started accepting that digital is, the mainstream and is going to be here for a long time. So though we feel that there are giants, and maybe because not too many people in India, that is why, we are probably leapfrogging. But I think we are leapfrogging because of the promise of data sovereignty. I think increasingly people are realizing that we need to have a partner who follows the law of the land. And this is actually happening in the mature market already. If you see, this is exactly how, you know, the Western world, you know, has operated. So it's just coming to India because I think we are anyway, we kind of follow, we can do the, we follow the catch-up mode. So I think it's just that, honestly, not because of the size or anything. In fact, when we said that we are the first public cloud, trust me when I say this, our internal team did not believe me. Our PR team did not believe me. And till the time we actually did a hell lot of research to identify that, yes, there actually nobody, you know, who is providing this solution, because it's intuitively so, right? We all felt that there could be others who might be, you know, providing this service.
Right, you know, give us some indication in terms of what is the kind of growth that you are seeing on a daily basis in terms of the kind of users and in terms of the target as to how many users you'd like to bring on board. I know that your 1 lakh target has really grown 10x. So what kind of target are you working with for the end of this financial year?
We want to keep on doing the work that we are doing and don't really want to aim a number as such. But just because it's a business and, you know, we feel that, see, our universe is extremely big. We've got 700 million internet users in the country, right? All of them are using, almost 500 million of them are using a smartphone, which means 500 million is our target audience, which is a huge target audience to have. We, on the other hand, we feel that if in next 18 months, and I'm probably talking about a little more than this financial year, we could cater to 10 million customers from India, I think we will feel that, you know, we at least have a sizable base. And that's not just because of the business. I will tell you what we mean by sizable base. We are actually intending to go to, you know, a decent amount of people so that we know that whether we are actually creating a product that is helping others or not. Because our dream is not just here, not just India. I mean, we would like to take this everywhere possible. But we also need a substantial size of audience for us to know whether our product is truly working or not. And we think that 10 million is a good, you know, target to have for us to test our product, bring in. There is a plethora of value-added services that the teams are working on, which we would want people to try and tell us, you know, how we could possibly get them better.
Seeing such a huge population will require you to have a very strong tech backend and a very strong system to be put in place. So at this point in time, are there any special provisions that you are making to ensure that you have a robust system without any glitches to service a larger population?
Honestly, you know, as they say, while we're doing testing, we're actually testing, you know, at our end, we have got a testing team which is doing the QC analysis, etc. But in reality is when they do something called a stress testing, which is essentially before we roll out anything out for the people to use, we also see how the same program is going to operate in a lot of people who are using it, right? So yes, there are processes in place, there are QC, you know, in a process in place, or both qualitative and programmatically, there are systems in place to take care of those. However, honestly, I think that we are far from calling ourselves a perfect product. I think we are increasingly learning, something or the other, you know, keeps on happening. And thankfully, we've got a decent team on board already in the last 6 months. We are almost 30 of us now, you know, who are kind of, you know, working on it. And considering the fact that only 4 or 5 of us had launched this program with 5 or 6 programmers. So from 10 to 30, that is also a significant growth that we have been able to, you know, have internally. And so far we've been bootstrapped. So, you know, we are just doing as much as we could. But to answer your question, yes, I think we have set up those processes in place to kind of take care of the inflow of people. However, I think there was a part of your question which kind of hinted towards the infrastructure. So yes, infrastructurally, I must tell you that we currently operating out of 2 data center partners who we have long-term contract with. As Digibox, we also intend to start our own data centers because that's, you know, one of the things which will allow us to multiply the kind of hardware support we would need vis-a-vis with having a partner who does their own job of procuring and setting up the infrastructure. But so far, I think, I mean, just to give you a prediction, we are subscribed to 2900 terabyte, which means we're almost 3 petabyte of storage. When we started, we planned for 5 petabytes. So there'll be a massive upgrade. From 5, we will move to a 25 petabyte, which is again a 5x growth in terms of the size that we, kind of infrastructure we already will be having ready.
You spoke about having your own data centers. What is the plan out there? That seems to be an interesting part of your overall strategy. So is there some further investment, some funds that will be required? So two questions as far as the data center expansion is concerned. And secondly, will you require more funds? You said you're bootstrapped at this point in time. So will you require more funds for this kind of expansion?
We intend to work with partners for as long as possible. But when we start our data center, we will be looking at two kinds of investment. And while there will be a private investor required who is probably going to understand our dream and therefore support us, but we would also need investment from the government. So we will be reaching out to various state governments who are continuously looking at creating SEZs and creating opportunities for businesses like ours, because cloud is actually an extremely future-focused industry. If you will understand this, you cover this beat, so you will definitely understand. So we are actually reaching out to the states and asking the authorities to create an infrastructure for us. So these two kind of investments we're already working on.
Right. You know, I wanted to talk to you on a larger front, which is basically when you talk about users and their evolving needs to be storing and using the cloud, do you think that this landscape has evolved and an average user will require more amount of cloud space than they do already? What is the kind of prediction that you're working with out there?
Yeah. In fact, you'll be very interested to hear this. I would like to cross-check the data. On an average, an Indian individual clicks 14 selfies a day. Okay, I don't know if you agree to that data, but and in a week, 30 selfies and 5 to 7 videos. And I'll tell you why am I talking about selfies and videos here. On an average, Indian mobile phones are anywhere between 32 GB storage memory, the internal memory that the phone has, which is basically anywhere between 7,500 to 9,999, right? And we have 95% mobile phones sold in the country, which are Android phones, right? If you check your phone, you will know that the latest OS, Android OS, actually is about 12 GB, the size of the OS, which means a 32 GB phone would already have only 20 GB left. Now, with the regime of 14 selfies a day and maybe 30 odd photos in a week and 5 videos in a week, we are talking about people creating almost 300 megabytes of new content every week, which actually kind of the prediction that we have, every average Indian is actually filling up their mobile phone in 4 to 6 months time. Now, what do you do in 6 months? You don't change your phone in 6 months. So people are actually going through the complete heartbreak of deleting their favorite photographs, their videos, or they actually have to store it either in a laptop by backing it up on a laptop or a hard drive or a cloud storage, right? Now, somebody who is buying a mobile phone between 7,500 rupees to 9,000 rupees, it is difficult for them to afford a 1,500 rupees package for just storing their photographs, which is almost 1/6 the price of your phone or 1/5 the price of your phone, right? So you would not like to spend that kind of money. So somebody had to kind of understand this challenge. And I think this is the challenge that we are working with. And by our prediction, I think India will be requiring 24 zettabytes of storage by the end of 2022 financial year. Okay, and we would like to be catering a significant part of that.
Data security, something that everybody is very concerned about. There's a lot of talk across platforms about how secure your data is, and but when you talk about data security, what kind of practices do you follow at DigiBox?
Right. So I think, as you rightly said, there is a lot of dialogue around data security. And unfortunately, though there is a concern, but a lot of people don't really understand what data security truly means, right? For a lot of people, data security just means not flashing their mobile numbers on an internet portal, which, by the way, is available. Like, there are maybe 1 million databases in the country, where not just mine or yours, everybody else's, you know, phone numbers and email IDs and names will be flashed. And every other day we hear some of the other organization that has, you know, been hacked by people. So, which essentially bring to my point is that it's a continuous endeavor, Priya. We have to be keeping at it. So what we're doing is we've created systems which are followed by global practitioners of security companies. And we have got we're kind of building a team which follows those practices, who are continuously fighting the odds, you know, where people are trying to infiltrate or they're trying to do some kind of a hacking attack at our data centers, et cetera, et cetera. So it's to answer your simple question is that it's a continuous attempt. It is not a one-time thing. And we are keeping at it. We will have to keep at it, you know.
Right. You know, I also want to talk to you about, you know, your paid users. You said that 10% of your users at this point in time are paid. But going forward, what kind of strategy do you think you will, you know, undertake to ensure that there are more paid users on your platform? And considering that there will be new features that you will be introducing on the platform, so give us a sense of both these aspects and whether these new features will tie in with getting more paid subscribers on board.
Yeah, so, you know, I don't know if you'll get it, but I'm saying we're extremely passionate about this business, but we are extremely dispassionate about the industry that we are in, which essentially means that we believe that storage is commodity. Okay. And we are not overtly, you know, making love to this concept of that what storage is. People would like to believe that there is storage that works fine. All my files are supposed to be backed up there and it is backed up there. When I need it, I will be able to get it. So we would like to get that confidence first, that here is an Indian alternate, here is an India first organization, which is providing the data sovereignty and security like everybody else, all the global players, at a price that does not pinch me. That is our first attempt. Second is when that is achieved, we are also continuously in talks with our customers. We have set up a client contact or client championship department, which are actually calling the users and asking them, you know, what are the kind of issues they're facing or what are the changes they would like to bring about. I mean, the other day there was a social media point, I think it was on Instagram, somebody said that, you know, why don't you guys come up with so we actually have a file limit of 10 GB at one point. So any file that you upload, it can maximum be of 10 gigabytes. Now, somebody wrote that, you know, why do you do that? Some other players who are charging a lot more than that, they are probably not having any kind of a limit of a file size. So that's why I'm a photographer. Can you please provide us with that option? So I think our social media team preempted and asked that, so what kind of a price point do you think? And actually he wrote that it's okay if it's a paid service. So they preempted and checked that, okay, what kind of price do you think you would like to pay? And what he quoted was almost 4x of the price point that he's operating currently, which essentially brings to us a very important point that Indians are ready to pay for things that they care about. And there are certain things that they don't want to pay, like, you know, having like a free storage, you know, which will just allow me to kind of double up my phone storage, etc. That they are not really ready to pay about. So yes, we are going to include these kind of services, which will be coming from the users. And then maybe they will become premium services. But overall, we don't foresee a reason for us to change our model, you know, at all.
Right. And just a final question with regards to your overall priorities going forward. I want to know three key priorities that you will be, you know, considering going forward. Of course, there is action and there is user acquisition, but top three priorities from your perspective?
I think our first priority is going to be building a little better experience for our customers. Okay. I think we have got an MVP in place, which is a minimum viable product. And we would be actually working with our customers themselves and making a better experience for them overall, from the product, from the way they interact with us, the way their queries are responded currently, with the pace of delivery, all of that. So that is going to be my priority personally. I am looking into it, you know, as we speak. That is one. Second is, you know, we want to actually, you know, kind of try and solve the problem that people are facing. Some of our competitors have actually now kind of gone back to their commitment and not really providing free storage like the way they used to provide. We would like to solve that problem. So there you would possibly see some auto syncing, you know, functionality being added to our platform, which will allow users to kind of connect their storages together, you know, and that's already an available service in the globe. We just want to bring it. So that's second. And third is we want to invest in the right kind of talent. I think finally it's a product, you know, it is not a physical product. It's actually, you know, finally a product that's been built by great programmers. So we want to actually focus and really get the right kind of talent and create an organization which actually provides the best employment possible. So these are three my priorities beyond the acquisition. You're right.
Right, Arnab. Many thanks for joining us today and sharing all your insights on the whole public cloud platform and the kind of storage available. I think the audience has really taken a lot of insights from this conversation, and we hope to see them on DigiBox very soon. Thank you so much for your time.